It begins innocently enough. You don't return a phone call. You break a date at the last minute. But in fact, it's the beginning of a pattern. And soon, your friend with mental illness realizes you're avoiding them. But what if you knew that your friendship was the key to their recovery? Would you still lock them out of your life?
Hi, I'm Megan McKenzie.
And I'm James Rowland.
And welcome to this edition of Teens in Action.
In this show, we focus on body image and eating disorders. We'll cover the effects of anorexia, bulimia, and how outside influences can change how we think about our bodies.
Your body image is what you think you look like. This may have nothing to do at all with your actual appearance.
So, we went out on the streets to see what teens have to say about body image.
Friends and family can influence your body image with positive and negative comments.
But teenagers are more concerned with the opinions of others. They want to fit in, be accepted, and admired.
Poor body image can lead to low self-esteem, dieting, anxiety, depression, and eating disorders. Do you know what body image is?
Just your body in general, like how you look on a day-to-day basis.
I think body image is what everyone perceives, or what you perceive of yourself.
Like how you look, like body image, like how you dress. It's
what people see from like television and all that. They think their body image should be a certain way, but it really shouldn't.
How you look?
Yeah, how you look, I guess, like to other people.
It's how you want to feel, how you want to look.
I don't know, I guess how people see you, the way you look, or just like how people see you.
Their sense of style that they like.
How you walk and like what people look at you as, like what you are.
It's the way you are, your shape, and if you love yourself,
how people see themselves.
Were you close?
The definition of body image is how you see your body and how you feel other people see you.
What outside influences affect your body image?
Basically, friends.
The media, your parents, your friends, just everything around you can influence anything you do.
The media, anything on TV. Now you want to be like who you see on TV.
I think celebrities,
fashion.
Music and TV and stuff,
your peers.
Definitely the media and what people see in magazines, television shows, like award shows. They see all these actors and actresses and what they're wearing, what they look like, and they think they should be that way.
Mass media, lots of fashion, music.
I guess the music you listen to, the people you look up to.
The media.
TV and athletes. Probably peers.
Teens in the United States are under pressure to measure up to a physical standard of what looks good.
What attracts you to another person?
The way they look, if they look nice.
Personality and physique.
Looks is what draws you to the person, but then personality is like what keeps you like attracted to the person.
They have to be fit.
I like their teeth.
Probably their personality.
If you have a great personality, you pretty much set.
It depends on how they are and how they are around my friends.
I would say personality.
Personality, I guess.
Their eyes, their hair, how they dress.
To me, it's like personality and stuff like that.
Basically, like how they look.
If they're active and healthy.
Well, blonde Swedish girls is always good.
Looks is definitely a thing that I guess gets attention because it's the first thing you see.
Their personality, the way they are and the way they treat you.
I guess confidence, like that's really attractive.
We went out and asked 100 teens this question. How do you feel about the way your body looks? For boys, 58% were satisfied with their bodies. But almost half of the boys polled stated that they were not happy with how their bodies look. Our polls show that only 28% of girls were satisfied with their body, leaving a large majority of girls not happy with how their bodies look, and 4% who like absolutely nothing about their appearance.
More than half of American young girls and women aged 12 to 23 are unhappy with their bodies.
Coming up, we talk with two young women who have struggled with and overcome their own self-destructive behaviors. But first, we have a question for you.
Did you know that when someone has a negative body image, they have a twisted view of how they look? They compare their size and shape to others and feel shameful and insecure. When you look in a mirror, do you like what you see? Think about it, and we'll get back to you after the break.
Everyone has friends. There's online friends. Friends to go out with on a Saturday night. Friends to hang out with and do nothing. Friends who show up on moving day. And then there are the friends who'll be there if someone is dealing with a mental illness. Are you one of those friends?
$20 million young lives thrown away. That's how many could contract HIV worldwide in the next few years. But it doesn't have to be like that. HIV is preventable. Go to knowhivaids.org.
So, what do you see when you look in the mirror? We all have our days when we feel awkward or uncomfortable in our bodies. The key to developing a positive body image is to recognize and respect our natural shape and learn to overpower those negative thoughts. Accept yourself. Accept your body.
Eating disorders are about more than just food and weight loss. It's a serious disorder that affects the mind and creates an obsession with appearance.
Recently, we've talked with Ava and Megan. We hope their experiences will help teens understand how this disorder affects so many young people.
How did your eating disorder begin?
I think my case was special. A lot of girls that you talk to, men and women alike, that have eating disorders are because somewhere along their childhood, they didn't have control of something. And the only thing that they felt like they could control was their food. And for me, I had the picture-perfect childhood, I guess you could say. My parents were amazing. In high school, I got a lead role in a play, the female lead role. And you know, when you're younger and you see all the actors, actresses, and they're all very skinny. And I wanted to lose weight really fast before the play. I thought to myself, what a better way to lose weight than to just be bulimic. It was supposed to be a short thing that turned into a long-term thing.
Definitely my mother's self-consciousness with her own body, abuse from my father at a very young age, and I think growing up with a sister who was very overachieving definitely led to my developing an eating disorder. Sometimes it plays out in different ways, but you know, there was a quote from a book I read several years ago. It's always really resonated with me, and it said, I was taught at a very young age how to be ashamed of my body. And I think for the most part, and you know, it's kind of all those standard things that you hear about, okay, well, this and that, and you line those things up, and then you have an eating disorder. Did you know the damaging effects that it was having on your body?
I was throwing up mostly everything that I ate, and then instead I would replace everything that I ate with pills. And I knew it wasn't very good for me. What I didn't know is how damaging it is to your teeth. I've had thousands of dollars in dental bills since then. I also didn't know the damage that it does to your esophagus, to your stomach. When you're bulimic, what happens is your metabolism slows down. And so everything that I ate that I couldn't get out of me right away, my body held on to. I definitely was unaware of the full blown damages.
What physical changes did your body go through as your eating disorder progressed?
So I went through a few changes. I think my face got a little more sunken in. My eyes were red all the time. But other than that, physically, I didn't get really, really skinny. I kind of stayed the same.
Going to get a haircut and the woman at the salon saying, "What happened to your hair?" And there was just this big chunk in the back that was gone. And I didn't even know. And I remember being in the hospital, having to tie the sides of my pants up with a string because they wouldn't give me a belt because I was just wasting away. Just physical weakness and you know, anemia, bruising, paleness. I'm still pale, but if you can imagine.
Did you ever try to hide your eating disorder?
I did try to hide my eating disorder. Oh my gosh, yes. I hid it very well. I hid it for years. I would lie to people about what I ate. I would lie to my parents. I'd throw food away. I would make dirty dishes in the sink for my mom.
I became a master of it, which isn't anything to brag about, but I hid it. Yeah, that was one of the difficult parts. You know, I almost became antisocial for a while because it got to the point where if I was in a social setting, I would eat, I would leave, I would be gone. And you do a lot of crazy things trying to hide stuff like that, especially from a family that, you know, is always in your business and wants to know what's going on and cares about you and your friends as well.
How do you think that all of this, your eating disorder, affected your friends and family?
When my family actually found out, by the time they found out, I was already done with it. My mom, I think it probably hurt her pretty bad the most, especially because I didn't really reach out for any help. I just kind of dealt with it by myself.
The disorder really affected my relationships with my friends and my family because when people try so hard to help you and you do nothing but push them away, as wonderful and loving and supportive as anybody can be, there's only so much anyone can take. It's important for people to not give up on you, even no matter how much you've pushed them away.
Can you tell us about the first time you were able to talk with someone about your situation?
The first time I really spoke with someone about my eating disorder was when my mother sent me to a therapist when I was 13. It was so strange to me, these questions. Have you ever made yourself throw up before? Like, no, throwing up's disgusting, why would I do that? And it didn't connect for me at that time, but I really liked the therapist who I ultimately ended up seeing for 7 or 8 years, actually, through the course of my disorder. He really helped me through a lot.
What small steps did you have to take in your recovery process?
I think the first step I had to take in my recovery process was the decision to actually let it go. It's a struggle, but staying disciplined to going to therapy groups, being open and honest with yourself and with your parents, I really surrounded myself with a group of people that really wanted to help me. And you have to find those people. The whole food thing was really hard for me, even if it was small meals. That way my body got used to metabolizing food again. And really just working on losing the whole guilt trip over food.
What changes did your body go through as you began to get control over your eating disorder?
I got my period back, my hair grew back.
As I gained control, I got more social again.
I was able to go out with my friends and not be afraid of, oh my God, are we gonna go somewhere where there's food? Now how am I gonna deal with it?
It's a great feeling. You know, here's something that you've done for so long and it's consumed you and you can finally let it go and you can be yourself again.
It renewed my self-esteem in a thousand ways. I wouldn't go back to it. I don't even think I'd be capable of it.
Do you still find yourself comparing yourself to other women or people around you?
All the time. But at the same time, I know that everybody's different and everyone's beautiful in their own way. And that took me a long time to figure out.
How should we approach someone that we think might be suffering from an eating disorder without upsetting them?
I think it's okay to upset them. They need to know and they need to see what they're doing to their body. You know, if somebody would have told me, you'll never ever have a chance to do music, or, you know, by the end of the day you'll have a voice, or you'll have thousands of dollars in dental bills, I'd have been like, oh, okay.
Do you have any advice for other teens today?
You're young. Things change. You grow up. People change. You're all different, and that's fine. As you grow up, you learn that the world's different, and that's what makes it beautiful.
I wasted 10 years of my life, if not more, to just depression itself and not living. It's such a waste because there's so much more that life can offer you.
So just embrace it. Just love it. That would be my advice. It's just high school. You'll get through it, I promise.
Next on our survey, we asked, do you feel pressure to have your body look a certain way? If yes, by whom? An overwhelming 68% of boys feel pressure from many people who influence their lives, including family, friends, media, and coaches. Unfortunately, we were not surprised to see that a majority of the girls surveyed feel outside pressure from friends, sports, media, and family to look a certain way.
Women risk their health and life trying to imitate the bodies presented by the media.
Media messages can also harm your mental self-image and self-esteem. Coming up, we ask teens what they think about these external influences.
Did you know that the physical images presented in the media are difficult, if not impossible, for most people to achieve? Does the media play a negative role in how teens view their bodies? Stay tuned and find out.
Richie, I want you to go to the house.
Yo, Ty, what up?
Richie, what up, player?
爺爺, 是你叫我不要判人的, 你記不記得? 記不記得?
How you doing, son?
All right, man.
I'm chilling, of course. You gonna be there, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Gotta play ball.
Imagine the power of one voice. Click freedomcenter.org to find yours.
Fruit. What a tasty treat. Fruits packed with potassium and other nutrients can help keep your heart pumping strong during the game. And they give you energy back so you can take on the next activity. Can your food do that? Run, throw, think, eat better. Find out more at smallstep.gov.
So, do you know how the media negatively affects how teens view their bodies? The overwhelming presence of media images has created a social and cultural ideal of extreme thinness, causing teens to feel that their own bodies are not acceptable. Remember to be aware of how outside influences can negatively affect how you feel about your body.
Society and the media has created a state of confusion and potential danger for many young people. Even guys talk about losing weight and changing their appearance.
Some teens want to lose weight, not to get healthy, but to get skinny, because they think skinny equals having a great life. So we ask teens how media messages affect how they see themselves.
Today's youth, especially girls, get mixed messages from the media. Images of thin women are an overwhelming presence. The average woman's body has become invisible. Let's hear what teens have to say about how the media influences their lives.
On average, Americans see around 2,000 ads every week. Which of the following is not a technique used by advertisers to get you to buy their product? A, they convince you that you need the product. B, they exaggerate the product results. C, they show real-life statistics. Or D, they make you feel that you are inadequate without the product.
C. I guess the last one.
Definitely C.
I would say C, more or less.
D.
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 I'd say D.
C.
B.
D, they make you feel like they're like you're not good enough unless you have that product. I don't see that a lot.
I'm going to say C.
I'm going to have to say C. What do you think?
Yeah, C.
Yeah.
I think C, definitely.
The answer is C. Advertisers rarely show real-life statistics.
A growing number of young women are risking their health and life trying to imitate the body images presented by the media.
How does the media, with their television shows, commercials, and magazines, change how we feel about ourselves?
They make you feel like you have to be skinny to be accepted.
They kind of look at you as you're not perfect until you buy this product.
Media affects girls even more than boys.
I guess it makes you feel like you need a certain product.
Especially the girls need to look like skinny. They need to have this type of hair. Their skin needs to be flawless. So definitely girls are affected way more.
Everything that you see outside, you know, like media-wise, it totally changes your persona.
They make some people feel less
comfortable with their bodies. They need this stuff to make them look better or fit in better with other people.
Images of female bodies are everywhere. Women and their bodies sell everything from food to cars. How many teens answered the next question correctly?
True or false? Of commercials targeting young adults, 50% of those geared for females promote physical attractiveness, while none of the commercials aimed towards males refer to their physical appearance.
I think it's false. I guess that could be true.
True. Yeah, true.
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 It's false, false.
Yes.
It's false.
Maybe they think there's more guys than girls that'll buy their product.
False.
I think it's true.
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 The answer is true. This shows us that advertisers commonly use the female body as an object to sell products. And unfortunately, this method of advertising is becoming more common in ads targeting men as well. Today's advertisers go to huge lengths to sell products. One of the most effective ways is to convince women that their bodies are never good enough. So we asked, why is it for girls that how they look is more important than who they are?
Well, when you talk to a guy and you ask him what he sees in a girl, you never really hear like her personality.
Because they think guys look for the body first, then the face, then how they act and how their appearance is.
Guys don't really get to know us for who we are. They just want our bodies, so we want to be wanted and we want to feel like we're needed. So we just want to like look good for them, even though that's not even it. They should get to know us and we should just be ourselves, and our bodies should stay how they are, because I think every girl's perfect in their own way.
The male mind, I guess, sees more of the physical attraction more than what's inside. And they see it as what represents you on the outside is what really matters to them.
Because everyone judges you by how you look before getting to know you.
They judge you by on how you look. They don't judge you on who you are right away. They judge you on, oh, look at that girl. She looks like this or she looks like that. They don't judge you on, oh, your personality. They don't try to get to know you before they right away just say something.
The typical girl thinks that if they don't look good, if they don't feel good, then they're not good enough to be wanted, they're not good enough to fit into society.
This time we asked, do you want to change something about your body? Almost half of the boys polled said that they would change at least one thing about their body. The most common change was that they wanted more muscles. More than half of the girls we surveyed stated that they definitely wanted to change something about their body.
People with eating disorders need to seek professional help.
Coming up, our panel of teens get information from experts who treat people with unhealthy eating behaviors.
Did you know that 3,000 young women die each year from complications due to eating disorders? Do you know how an eating disorder can affect your body? Hang tight and see if you have the answer.
I have plenty of friends that have dropped out of high school.
I was expelled from school.
I have that ADD thing to where I can't really pay attention that well. Might as well just drop out.
School was very difficult. So I bounced from like foster home to foster home. I thought I was never gonna see my family or friends again.
Cause people get killed in broad daylight.
I was hanging out with some people. Now I realize I shouldn't have. They join gangs, start doing drugs, try to sell drugs. It distracts you from everything around you. You're always having to watch your back. You can't really be yourself.
Chill out. Don't tell me to chill out when you're stealing my things. I wouldn't have to raise my voice if you would just give it back and stop being like a criminal.
I don't have your cell phone.
Oh God, look at yourself. What are you offering?
Is this a thief's uniform? You see all these people standing around here? Why am I the one?
I'm sorry, homie. Okay?
What?
Don't make this a big deal. Just give it back, okay?
Did you see me?
I just know you took it.
Where are your witnesses?
Look at
where are your witnesses? Did you see me?
Hey, you left this in the bathroom.
So, how does an eating disorder affect your body? Here are just a few of the many serious side effects. Loss of bone mass, leaving you with bones that are like a 50 to 70 year old person. Dental problems, leaving you with rotten teeth and bleeding gums.
Heart problems. Heart disease is a common cause of death for people with anorexia. And infertility. Malnutrition and vitamin deficiencies during and after an eating disorder can cause infertility, premature births, and major birth defects.
A negative body image encourages many types of self-destructive behaviors.
When looking for help for any type of eating disorder, it's hard to know where to go. Next, our team panel gets useful information from the experts on this issue.
Hi, I'm Brianna Whitman. In this segment, we will try to better understand what disordered eating means. To do that, we ask the experts for advice. Our panel experts are psychologist Patricia Pitts, PhD, and Christy Morell, a registered dietitian. We ask Dr. Pitts, what is a psychologist's role in helping a patient with an eating disorder?
A psychologist's role in working with an eating disorder patient is first and foremost to be an eating disorder specialist and also be able to really listen to that individual's story by really building a safe environment and rapport building and support for the individual to be able to feel like they can really come out and be all that they are meant to be.
Next, we have Christy Morell. Christy counsels many women and men who are coping with eating disorders at her private practice, New Directions. She also works at USC, providing nutrition classes and individual sessions to help students understand healthy eating patterns. We asked Christy, how does a dietitian help someone with an eating disorder?
A dietitian helps patients with eating disorders through a series of process of helping educate them on what is healthy. I think the biggest problem is people get their information from TV, magazines, friends, and a lot of it is misinformation about what's really healthy. Like, one of the problems is a lot of people think that you shouldn't eat after a certain time, like you can't eat after 8 o'clock, or carbs is bad. So the first thing that a dietitian does is educate them on what the truth and the facts are. And then it's slowly just helping them establish a better relationship with food.
As you can see, we have the answers to our questions on tape. We did this because we wanted to have teens comment on what our experts had to say. So now, I would like to introduce our teen panel. Royce, Ella, Amelie, and Zach. Now, both Christy and Dr. Pitts had an eating disorder. Here's what they had to say about their own experiences.
My personal history of dealing with an eating disorder was anorexia in high school, my junior and senior year, and then in college, my freshman year was bulimia, and that was purging through exercise.
I had anorexia nervosa, restricting type, when I was 11 to 15, and at that time, it was in the mid 60s, early 70s, not very many people knew about it.
Now for our first question. What are the most common signs of an eating disorder?
One category would be the actual eating disorder symptoms themselves. So one thing that I see often is people are restricting their food. They start hiding food, hoarding food, moving food around on their plate. So there's a lot of activities and energy around the food behavior itself. Like, you might see a person more drawn, more emaciated. They might have a bump on their forefinger from putting their finger in their mouth and vomiting. They might just have lower energy. The whole demeanor starts changing. Another point is they might start having a lot of social withdrawal, so their behaviors change a lot also, or other kinds of signs that kind of show a person with an eating disorder.
The most common signs of an eating disorder are if somebody has lost weight in a small period of time, for example, over a month, that you see somebody dramatically have lost weight, or somebody wearing abnormally like baggy clothes to hide their weight is also another sign. They just become to isolate themselves. They don't want to go out anymore. They used to be very fun, go out to eat, and they just decide that they no longer want to be a part of any social settings with has to do with food.
Our next question is for Christy. How does starvation and purging affect your body?
Starvation and purging can affect the body by compromising your immune system, and meaning that you would get an infection much quicker or get sick a lot longer and a lot quicker by having a compromised immune system. You can have irregular heartbeat. Some people who are anorexic, who have lost their menstruation, basically have a compromised bone health. They start losing bone loss much more rapidly.
So then we asked, what are the underlying issues?
One of the things that I see most as an underlying issue for eating disorders is the pressure that they get from family, friends, and the media. When I ask a lot of clients how they feel like they got to the place that they're at now, a lot of them will say because of their families, because of their moms typically, the pressure that was put on them. Another big issue is friends, that people make fun of people who are overweight. So they want to look a certain way, they want to be able to fit into certain clothes, and so that's another big pressure, as well as the media.
So how long does it take to recover from an eating disorder?
Everybody has their own story. The sooner an eating disorder is caught, the sooner we can get on top of it and hopefully turn it around. And in those cases, I would say probably about 2 years from kind of beginning to end. When a person actually has an eating disorder, is in the middle to the latter stages of the eating disorder, they probably have already had 3 to 5 years of a lot of stuff building up that got to the point of where they're at now. So there's a lot of work to change where a person's coming from. I also see people who at different developmental stages, like going away to school, getting married, after having a baby, that their eating disorder keeps flaring up. And that's partly because they haven't completely resolved some of the underlying issues, and so it becomes their way of coping when they're in crisis.
For your body to recover from an eating disorder depends on how long you've had the eating disorder. If you've been binging and purging for years, it's going to take a very, very long time because you've done a lot of damage. Things that you want to look good for, or you know, you want your body to go back after having a baby, and it really doesn't, and you can become obsessive. But I think the thing to remember is that you have the tools and you get the help that you need, so you can just, you know, understand what's going on and deal with it and then move on.
So how can family and friends help someone they believe has an eating disorder?
Family and friends can help by approaching them very delicately, one-on-one. For example, if you notice a friend who usually is very social and they start to not want to go out, is pulling them aside and asking them, you know, I've just noticed that you haven't been very social. Is anything going on? Are you okay? I'm worried about you. I care about you. Just know that I'm here if you want to talk about anything. That's the best thing that you can do. You don't want to ever do like a huge intervention with a bunch of people and a lot of friends, because it's a very personal subject, and it's also very shameful. A first step might be to make an appointment with a dietitian, and that way the dietitian can help them understand if that's something that they need to go see a psychologist for.
I think the advice that I would give to someone who has an eating disorder, is concerned about a friend who has an eating disorder, is to seek some kind of professional help with someone who does specialize in eating disorder. And I think it can go in different directions. I mean, if a person feels more comfortable to go to a medical doctor, to get some lab work drawn, and to be open and honest with the medical doctor about their physical concerns, then they can walk in the door that way. If they would feel more comfortable going to a registered dietitian who's a specialist, a psychologist who's a specialist, just so they get in the door to someone who really truly understands eating disorders, and then that professional would be able to know how to direct that person to the most comprehensive care that that individual can get.
We asked our experts if there was anything else that they'd like to add.
If this is true about you, I would encourage you to seek some support through a friend, a parent, and ultimately through professional care.
In order to be healthy, you need a well-balanced diet, and you need to be having a certain number of carbohydrates, a certain number of fats in your diet, a certain number of vegetables, dairy products, proteins, and also what's really important as well is a moderate level of activity. Not anything obsessive, but you should be exercising or getting some type of activity every day for maybe 30 to 45 minutes. Just being active, maybe going for a hike, doing something that you enjoy, going for a bike ride with friends, doing something that's fun. It doesn't necessarily have to be, I need to go to the gym and get on a treadmill. It can be outside, it can be something leisure and fun. You just need to move your body.
So, any comments?
Yeah, I think it's important that you know, there's no one underlying reason or cause for a person to contract like anorexia or any other eating disorder. It's a three-part thing, you know, like socially, physically, and mentally. And just interesting to see how, you know, socially, like the media or our family has that issue, like affects us. And even physically, like our genetics can even give us a predisposition to some of these diseases. And mentally, you know.
Yeah, the issues are a lot more serious than you hear about usually.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's important for everyone to know how bad starvation really affects your body.
I thought it was interesting. I didn't realize that family members influenced people that have eating disorders as much. I knew about friends and media, but...
Yeah, we should all be thankful that we're all healthy and fit, but...
You have to realize that there's a lot of pressure coming from everyone and everywhere. You know, you want to sit down and watch TV and you see it there. You know, you're talking to your mom and it's right there. It's really hard to deal with those emotions.
Thank you to Christy Morell and Dr. Pitts for helping us to better understand the many sides of an eating disorder. And thank you to our teen panel for your comments.
Sure,
no
problem.
Anytime.
You're welcome.
This time we asked only boys this question. What do you think about steroids? Fortunately, most boys know that steroids are dangerous. However, 12% of boys still stated that they would use them if they could. And another 7% thought it was okay for professional athletes to use steroids. Then we asked if they know someone who uses steroids. Surprisingly, 23% of those polled know someone who is using steroids to enhance their body and performance. To keep it even, we asked only girls this question. Have you considered an eating disorder method as a solution to weight loss? It was scary to see that 3 out of 9 girls had in fact considered it. Their answers describe methods that define anorexia, purging, extreme dieting, and excessive exercise.
10% of anorexics are now male, and even more men suffer from addiction to exercise and body issues.
As we have learned throughout our show, this disorder can affect anyone. Coming up on our FYI segment, we'll have a recap of what you should remember.
Did you know that recovery from an eating disorder is possible? Counseling, medical treatment, and nutritional advice will help you regain control of your life. What types of treatment do eating disorder centers offer? We'll have the answers for you after the break.
It's easy to tell if you've had way too many. But what if you've had just one too many? Buzz driving is drunk driving.
I'm good, bro.
Get that movie,
dude. Man.
This is pirated.
So?
So, I wanted the real thing.
What's the difference, man?
The difference? So when I start making movies, people ripping me off.
I wouldn't rip you off, man.
Prove it.
So, did you remember what type of treatment eating disorder centers offer? Here's a few things to look for. Individualized programs, treatment tailored to the needs of each patient. Psychological counseling, therapy helps you understand what's going on. Nutritional counseling, dietitians help you change your negative attitude towards food. Plus, educational programs for individuals and their families.
We've covered a lot of information in this show. Here's some basic facts that you should be aware of.
It's important to remember that a person who has an eating disorder does not need to appear underweight or even average weight to suffer from any of these signs and symptoms. Anorexia. Some of the most common signs are avoidance of food at all costs, person who denies feeling hungry, even though they seldom eat. Development of rituals surrounding food that may include eating in secrecy or rearranging the food on one's plate. Dramatic weight loss that occurs over a relatively short period of time and is not associated with an illness. Bulimia. Some of the most common signs are binge eating, where a person will consume vast quantities of food in one sitting. Self-induced vomiting that occurs after eating. Frequent trips to the bathroom after meals. Inappropriate and frequent use of laxatives or diuretics. Excessive exercise. The most common signs are missing work, parties, or other appointments in order to work out. Working out for hours at a time each day. Working out with an injury or while sick. Feeling extremely anxious if unable to exercise.
There are a lot of places where you can get additional information about this topic.
Here are some websites you should check out.
The Bella Vita is a center for treating eating disorders through all levels of care, with an emphasis on spiritual wellness. On their website, you can find numerous treatment options and information. Check out what they have to offer at thebellavita.com. The National Eating Disorders Association is the largest nonprofit organization in the United States working to prevent eating disorders and provide treatment referrals to those suffering from the disorder. You can find a variety of resources for those suffering and their family members at nationaleatingdisorders.org. Treating an eating disorder is not easy. The National Association for Anorexia Nervosa and Associated Disorders is an organization dedicated to informing and helping those suffering. To see their extensive resources for finding support and treatment, go to anad.org. The New Directions Eating Disorders Center is an outpatient treatment center. Their programs help each client work through their conflicts and restore nutritional well-being and healthy eating patterns. Check out what they have to offer at newdirectionseatingdisorders.com.
We want to thank Ava and Megan for helping us understand what it's like to struggle with and overcome an eating disorder. And Dr. Pitts and nutritionist Christy Morell for the dedication to helping people regain control of their lives.
Thank you for joining us. We hope this show gave you something to think about. Please know there's always someone you can talk to.
See you next time on Teens in Action.
Bye.
We'll be right back.
People want to believe you're okay, so it's easy to pretend you're okay.
I don't want advice. I just want to talk to somebody who gets it.
There's no way to explain what it feels like. You just want to stop, get off the ride.
Have you ever lost your belief? Watching your faith turn to grief. Won't you give?
Thing is, it does get better. Just believe that. You gotta believe that.
If you're having a hard time or know someone who is, call or log on for more information at 1-877-495-0009 or visit www.nostigma.org.